In 1976, NASA sent two Viking spacecraft to Mars to photograph the planet and test for the presence of life. Two of these photographs revealed a large human face accompanied by a massive five-sided pyramid. Some call the face the Martian Sphinx. These findings were presented at the United Nations to an audience of scientists and journalists. Here's an excerpt from that presentation by Richard C. Hoagland, science writer and winner of the Angstrom Medal for Excellence in Science for his research in the Mars investigation.
Artifacts. And in 1976, during the unmanned mission to Mars, the Viking mission, lo and behold, frame 35A72 taken on an afternoon on Mars of a northern Martian desert called Cydonia. We, the human race, NASA, the United States of America, the American people who paid for the mission, spotted and noted an enigmatic artifact that did not belong, the so-called face on Mars. Now, many things have happened in the ensuing years, but I wanted to show you the original data to show you how far we have come, because, of course, the official response when this photograph was first presented to the media and to the world was that it was, in fact, a trick of light and shadow. Well, from that has come an investigation, some books, some videos, a lot of discussion, and we are here this afternoon. Now, this is a computer-enhanced version of exactly the same image done 15, 16 years later. Notice the remarkable level of detail, cross lines on the forehead, scalloping on the left side here, the suggestion of teeth in the mouth, deep-set eyes. But again, if we only had one picture, we would never know if, as NASA has said consistently for 16 years, this was merely the most marvelous trick of erosion on the surface of any planet, or, in fact, was something else. For that, you require another set of data, such as this. This is now a second frame taken 35 days after the first frame. And DiPietro and Molinar, two imaging engineers at the Goddard Space Flight Center who got into this very early on in 79 and 80, they were the ones, not NASA, to cull through the 60,000 Viking images in the archives and to find this picture. And when they processed it, lo and behold, this object turned out to be remarkably bilaterally symmetric. Now, we mean by that it seems to have a left and a right half. There appear to be two eye sockets, the mouth goes through, the hairline appears to go around, there's proportion of symmetry, about 95%. Now, facial expressions we see in mountains or in landscapes here on Earth are inevitably perspective shots, profiles, where if you move 100 meters one way or the other, they go away. What made this different was it was a frontal, full-on facial view, as if you were looking at yourself in some kind of cosmic mirror. And maybe that's a telling metaphor for exactly what this was intended to be, if and when we climbed up the ladder to spaceflight, journeyed across space to Mars, and looked down and saw it staring back. Time will tell. For the last 9 years, the argument has raged regarding the reality of this object as a constructed artifact. Well, our focus has now begun to shift. We're looking more at the meaning of this object, including a possible connection with the Earth. The key to our apparently successful solution to the riddle of Cydonia, which is the name of the region on Mars where Viking initially photographed the face, turned out not to be the face at all, but a 2-mile-long, half-mile-high, five-sided pyramid located a few miles away. It was Errol Torren, our team member on loan from the Defense Mapping Agency, who cracked the code, because Torren found, when measuring the internal geometry of the D&M pyramid, that it contains incredible geometric structure, fundamental mathematical constants, which in the universe are the key to signifying the presence of intelligence. This is the Sphinx. We're now looking at a structure, a magnificent, monumental work of art, created at a time when nobody else on planet Earth is supposedly able to do anything of that magnitude or scale. There's no other contemporary civilization to pin it on. So who did it? And before you say Martians, just sit there and listen, okay? Okay, I don't want you to leap here. Science has now opened. I mean, rigorous science has opened the doorway to what, in I think it was John's parlance, the dreaded A word, Atlantis. Is it conceivable that the mythos that came down to us through Plato, speaking of a prior high civilization capable of things like this, is maybe not a myth? But in fact, we're seeing at least one surviving, albeit very ancient, artifact that you can touch of that halcyon day when we could do things that we no longer can do. Something ineffable brushed an earlier phase of human history and left a monument that recorded in some form the echo of that signal. The basic model of the Sphinx is this lion-man interface. We began to look seriously at the possibility that there was more than a passing connection between this awesome structure and the monuments of Mars. Well, take a look. As you progress through the various imaging enhancements, this is high sun now, all right, you can very definitely see that this guy has a simian proto-human look. What you then do is you take the halves, all right, and you fold over. All right, let me go back one. You fold over this half, all right, onto that half so that you can actually get a mirror image, and it's very definitely primitive hominid. It's not Marilyn Monroe or Paul Newman. Why is it primitive hominid? Might it have something to do with how old we think this thing might be? Circa half a million years. Hold that thought. Then what we do is we go back to the original, all right, and we then take the right half and we do the same thing. We fold that over and we get this. And I'm really gratified by your response, guys, because that's exactly my feeling. The hair on the back of my neck. When I realized that what we were looking at in the monument of Mars, the face on Mars, was the fusion of the hominid and the feline, the fusion of this persona from this, I realized that what we were seeing was, of course, sphinxes, literal embodiments of sphinxes on two worlds linked by the fundamental constants of Cydonia over and over and over again.
The most accepted ideas are sometimes the hardest to overturn. They seem so obvious. The Earth is flat. Man cannot fly. Man will never walk in the moon.
For me, though, the idea of looking back at Earth from deep space and seeing it in a new perspective, that's the most profound experience of the entire space program.
Dr. Edgar Mitchell, ex-Navy astronaut, was one of the few men to walk on the moon.
An example of changing thought structure is the classic one that begins with Copernicus, when Copernicus challenged the existing notions that all the heavens moved around the Earth, that the Earth was the center of creation, and it didn't appear from his observations that was true. And so he invented or created the heliocentric theory that said all the planets move around the sun. And that was certainly resisted at the time. Fortunately, Copernicus was a rather wise man. He didn't challenge the existing system till he was near death, and it was published after his death, as a matter of fact. It was Galileo that came along with his telescope and saw planets moving around, like moons moving around a planet, and suggested that maybe Copernicus was right, that Earth was moving around the sun. Unfortunately, the authorities of the day didn't want to even look through Galileo's telescope. They were quite confident they knew the answer without looking at new evidence. If geological evidence and dating evidence suggest that the Sphinx is much older than we previously believed, it raises great questions for our concepts of how humanity evolved over the last 100,000 years. If geological evidence and dating evidence suggest that the Sphinx is much older than we previously believed, it raises great questions for our concepts of how humanity evolved over the last 100,000 years. Those are pretty well-established notions as well. So if the Sphinx is proven to be much older, it raises a huge question mark as to what sort of sophisticated civilization could possibly have existed to create this monument.
There is simply not a single shred of evidence that has been presented by any competent Egyptologist that suggests that there was any high culture before the pre-dynastic period. Can we have missed it? Sure we can have missed it. I could also grow wings and fly back home tonight, but I think the probability of that happening is just about as good as the probability of us having missed the evidence of such a high culture. Archaeologists, you have to remember, are not the sort of Indiana Jones with a bullwhip and set the dynamite charges kind of people that the films portray us to be. They're very meticulous workers who pore over every scrap of material that comes out of the ground. They don't use picks and shovels. They use brushes and scalpels to scrape away the dirt and to examine what's there. You're talking about an enormous amount of care that is put into the work that archaeologists do, and I doubt very much that the hundreds, the thousands of Egyptologists who worked in the Nile Valley since, let's say, the 1880s would have missed even one little bit of evidence for such a purported earlier civilization.
Many archaeologists and Egyptologists have been highly resistant to my ideas. If my findings are in conflict with their theories, maybe it's time for them to reevaluate their theories about the rise of civilization. I'm not saying that the Sphinx was built by Atlanteans or people from Mars or extraterrestrials. I'm just following the science where it leads me, and that leads me to conclude that the Sphinx was built much earlier than previously thought.
Shock and I have a friendly debate going about the age of the Sphinx. Shock holds to his 5,000 to 7,000 BC date, mainly by taking the most conservative view allowed by the data to hand. I think, for a variety of both intuitive and scholarly reasons, that the date is much, much older. Shock isn't even in disagreement about this, but he prefers to take the most conservative view. I think that when and if our isotopic analysis and other areas that we're working in provide a date that, or provide data that we think is trustworthy, that date is going to be very, very old indeed. I think older than 10,000 BC, really older than 15,000 BC, and it wouldn't even surprise me if the date was a lot older than that. I really do believe that when we get a date, it's going to be something so staggering that nobody's going to believe the data.
West and his team have presented compelling new evidence that the Sphinx was eroded by rain. Now, does this prove that the Sphinx and its temple complex are thousands of years older than history tells us? The geology says yes, but we need more evidence. Recently, scientific techniques have been developed which could shed new light in the mysterious cavities under the Sphinx. West and his team are presently awaiting the invitation of the Egyptian government to continue their investigation.
What is it about this legendary guardian of sanctuaries that continues to fascinate mankind?
Well, the Sphinx is one of the best-known images in the universe. I mean, everybody knows about the Sphinx. It's certainly the symbol of Egypt. And I think it's a symbol of mystery and intrigue. And there's something very magical about the Sphinx. And I think everybody that looks at its image feels that mystery and that magic.
I'm a typical scientist / engineer that, you know, I love my data, I love to play with my data, and I love to see what it's telling me, and ensuring that what I'm producing is the best possible product. But now you take that to saying that something that I did with a sledgehammer and trying to avoid camels and horses may have some impact on how the world looks at its own past history. That's kind of mind-boggling. And like I said, I really haven't, that hasn't settled with me that much yet.
Each branch of science operates within its own individual paradigm. We're rocking the boat. We're looking at this problem from a new perspective, and we're providing some new and different answers that perhaps the establishment is not comfortable with. We're setting out to redate history, and the evidence certainly points to the fact that John West's theory is correct.
An older Sphinx would drastically revise our current view of man's early history. Are we heirs to a richer legacy than we ever dreamed of, from a civilization not of hunter-gatherers, but of great artists, architects, and scientists? A civilization in command of technologies we do not yet understand and cannot reproduce. Perhaps there were Egyptians before the flood. Some think they were Atlanteans. But whoever they were, the Sphinx stands in mute testimony to their existence.